Hi, and welcome to the iPhone Life podcast. I'm Donna Schill, editor-in-chief at iPhone Life.
I'm David Averbach, CEO and publisher.
And I'm Hal Goldstein, founder of iPhone Life.
We're so excited to have Hal on the episode today. As he just said, Hal is our founder. He founded our tech publication in 1985, and he's joining us today. You may also recognize him from the magazine. He's been writing a regular column called iView ever since we started iPhone Life magazine. So thanks so much for joining us, Hal.
My pleasure.
And we brought him on today to give a hands-on review of the iPhone 15 Pro Max, as well as the new Apple Watch Ultra. Both Hal and I have the new phones and have a lot to say about it. David hasn't gotten his yet, which a lot of you at home may be in the same boat as him, so waiting till November.
Well, yeah, one of the things we'll get into is obviously the most important thing. What color did we choose?
Yes.
And I made the mistake of going with the natural titanium, which was like really back ordered. I also made the mistake of sleeping in. So those two things combined for I get my phone in November. So stay tuned for my hands-on review. But today I'll just be moderating.
Yes.
Is the natural the white one?
It looks like a literal just titanium metal. So it's kind of silvery, but not, I don't know if I'd quite say white.
Okay.
Yeah, a little bit of a gold hue in there too.
Because I switched so that I could get it the first day.
Yeah, I almost did. I felt silly waiting longer for the natural titanium, but it just, I don't know. I'm such a sucker for like the new cool color, so.
Yeah, so we'll get all into all of that in a minute, but first we have a message from our sponsor.
Today's iPhone Life podcast is brought to you by Zugu. Zugu makes, in my opinion, the best iPad case on the market. I've tried out a bunch and Zugu is my favorite. It's got all kinds of articulation so you can set it on a table or on your lap and always adjust it to the perfect angle. It's also a super protective case, so it's gonna protect your device from drops, and they even guarantee this. They will cover the costs of Apple Care repairs if your device is damaged while it's in a Zugu case. I also think it looks really sharp, and they've got a bunch of stylish color options to choose from. My favorite feature though is the case is magnetic, so you can stick it on the fridge for out of the way storage, or you can stick it right up there and stream a movie or refer to a recipe while you're in the kitchen cooking. I use it this way all the time. Find out why they've got over 75,000 five-star reviews. Get your Zugu case today at zugucase.com. That's Z-U-G-U-case.com. This week's episode of the iPhone Life podcast is brought to you by Informant 5. Informant 5 is a calendar app for the iPhone, iPad, Apple Watch, and Mac, which combines a bunch of productivity functions into one interface. This means that all of your tasks, meetings, contacts, and notes can be found in one place. Personally, I find that Apple's calendar app can be a little confusing to use. Informant 5 has improved on this concept by adding more functionality and making the interface simpler to use. For instance, in the monthly view on Apple's calendar app, sometimes you'll just see a little dot if you have something scheduled. Informant 5 is a little better in this regard because in the monthly view, you can actually see the text of everything you have scheduled in the month. They've got a free trial going on right now. Check it out. Try it for yourself. You can look up Informant 5 on the App Store or go to pocketinformant.com to find it. Upgrade your calendar app today with Informant 5. Today's iPhone Life podcast is brought to you by Withings. Withings makes smart health gear that pairs with your Apple devices. They make a blood pressure cuff called the BPM Connect, which is super easy to use and connects neatly with your iPhone. They also make a smart scale called the Body Comp, which measures way more than just weight, like bone mass, water ratio, and body fat. They make a smart watch called ScanWatch, which does almost everything the Apple Watch does, and it looks a lot more stylish, more like a classic timepiece. My favorite of their devices is their sleep tracking mat, which goes underneath your mattress and measures all of your sleep phases. And the coolest thing about Withings stuff is that all of their gear integrates seamlessly with the Apple Health app. So it measures all those health metrics, and then you can see it or share it with your doctor if need be. You can find Withings at their website, withings.com. That's W-I-T-H-I-N-G-S.com.
Next up, I wanted to take a minute to tell you about our free amazing newsletter called iPhone Life Tip of the Day. We have over 500,000 happy subscribers who get a free tip in their inbox every day that teaches them something cool they can do with their iPhone in just 1 minute. We have people writing in all the time saying they like to read their tip over their morning coffee, get a quick new tip of something they can do on their iPhone and go along their day. You can go to iPhoneLife.com/dailytip to sign up. So I have a tip on the theme of the iPhone 15 Pro that I wanted to share with you all, and that's how to customize the action button on this new device. So we'll be getting into that later in the episode, but only the iPhone 15 Pro and Pro Max have this new button. It's in the place that the sleep-wake button used to be, or the silence button on other iPhones. And so now you have the ability to choose what you want that button to do. And this is one of my favorite features of the 15 Pro. How about you, Hal?
Yeah, I really like it. Yes.
Because you can just silence your phone in Control Center. So, and that's what I always like to have my phone silenced.
And I feel like there's two types of people in the world, the people that always have their phone silenced and the people who never have their phone silenced. And I don't know a lot of people that were always like toggling it on and off with that physical switch. So yeah, it seems like a really great addition, a much more useful button.
Yeah, I'd always forget anyway, one way or the other.
Exactly.
Yeah. Do you tend to keep your phone on silent or not?
It depends on the, it just goes back and forth, but I guess silence more than non-silence. Yeah.
Me too. That's a button I can, for the most part, just always keep on silent. But the action button I found to be really amazing for the flashlight, because usually when you need a flashlight in the dark, you don't want to be fumbling around and trying to get to your control center. So that's one of the actions you can take with this button. The way that you do it, this is the tip, is go into your settings app on your iPhone 15 Pro or Pro Max, go to action button, which is a new option near the top of that setting. And from there, you'll be led through 5 different options. You can still do the silent mode if that's what you like. You can set up a focus mode. I tried this out for a while, having my work focus mode through the action button.
You were so claiming that was your thing. You're going to be a work focus mode action button.
Yeah. And I'm probably going to rotate different things for the fun of it. But with that, I did find that most of the time when I'm setting my work focus mode, I'm doing it on my Mac anyway. It's the easiest to get to it through my
Mac
control
center. That makes sense. And you always have your Mac out while you're working. So
exactly. Camera is another one, which I think is a good one.
Yeah, I use 2 of them, but I use a camera one when I'm taking a walk in the morning in our woods.
That's really nice.
And all of a sudden, you know, the sunrise or whatever it is, and I'm just ready to go. Just clicking that action button and then clicking it again to take the photo.
And what's the second one you use?
At night, I like to listen to some audio for 20 minutes. And so I programmed a shortcut so that I could just press the button and in 20 minutes it'll shut off.
And is there an easy...
That's really nice.
So again, I don't have it, so I'm going to be sort of the
listener. And it's easy to do the shortcut.
Cool.
Because I never did a shortcut before.
Well, just to do a quick plug, we have a shortcuts course coming up in December. So,
yeah. There you go. But so for insiders listening, that starts December 6th.
Yes, thank you. Insiders only. So is it easy to toggle between shortcuts? Like, is that something that, or between action button?
Well, that was
functions?
What actually, I was going to give that as a tip, but I'll give it right now.
Okay.
So it's actually quite easy because basically I just do a spotlight search and type A, and it's used to action button. So it immediately comes up with action button, and then I just switch it. It just toggling, moving it over. And so it just takes 15, 20 seconds to switch it.
Oh, that's a good hack. Spotlight search is something David and I are always telling people to use more.
Yeah.
It's the fastest way to open apps a lot of times, but now it's also the fastest way to get to a lot of settings.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was getting ready to say. With iOS 17, now you can actually do actions from the Spotlight search, so it makes it even faster.
Yeah, so... voice memo is another option that Apple gives. Magnifier, which opens the camera and zooms in on things so you can read more easily. And then shortcuts, that's the last most advanced option you can use for the action button. I haven't done that.
They really make it easy.
Hal is the impressive one who has.
No, I'm not impressive. They make it so easy that they just have all these shortcuts laid out and how to do it. It was painless.
Cool.
That's awesome. Because we have our shortcuts course coming up, I think, with the Apple Watch Ultra and the iPhone 15 Pro Mac Pro line now having shortcuts programmable through the action button. It's going to make people want to use shortcuts more. And there are a lot of like preset options in the app that are easy. And then you can customize and build your own. That's much more complicated. But I have found even some of the basic ones take some fiddling with. In the shortcuts app.
I swear this didn't take me more than a couple minutes.
Really?
And I'm not the fastest guy learning stuff always. So this was pretty straightforward.
Cool.
So in our show notes of the episode, we'll have a link to how to program your action button in case we lost any of you there. I'll also link to a couple shortcuts articles for getting started with that if you're curious about that.
Before we move on, my concern with the flashlight feature, actually, for the action button in general, does a flashlight accidentally turn on? Have you had it happen yet where it like turns on in your pocket?
Hasn't happened because it's you press and hold the action button.
Okay.
So you have to hold it down for like 2 seconds or something. And it hasn't gone off by accident, which is somewhat surprising.
Yeah, well, because my concern was that the flashlight drains your battery. So if you accidentally turned it on and had it on all day, it could really affect your battery life. But that makes sense that they have it to press and hold because, it's a button on the side of your phone. You don't want to be accidentally toggling on and off all day.
But I don't like it's a little bit the 3 buttons in a row. Like sometimes when I want volume on or volume off, and then I might press the wrong button.
Same.
Yeah.
That's been happening to me too. Yeah. Well, moving along, I wanted to take a moment to tell you about our premium subscription called iPhone Life Insider. iPhone Life Insider is a community of over 16,000 Apple enthusiasts and lifelong learners who turn to Insider to master their Apple devices. We have live courses going on all the time, including the Shortcuts course coming up in December and our iPad course coming up in November. We have digital subscription to iPhone Life magazine. We're coming out with our buyer's guide in November with all the Apple gear you need for your devices. We have Ask an Expert, where you can come with a specific tech question and one of our 20 Apple experts will get back to you personally and help solve your problem. We have in-depth guides, including downloadable PDFs and on-demand videos. So it's a really fun community and a great way to master your Apple devices and have fun. So join us at iPhoneLife.com/podcast discount. That way you can claim 30% off your subscription just for being a podcast listener. And we also offer a 10% extra discount if you're a senior service personnel or veteran.
And if we also recently released our iOS 17 guide. So if you have not yet, if you're not yet an insider, this is the perfect time because this guide walks you through everything you need to know to master iOS 17. And there's so many hidden tips and tricks that we walk you through. So really awesome guide and great time to subscribe.
You know, I've got to tell you, I'm a consumer, but I was a slowly adopted consumer. I'm semi-retired from I've got my own life. And so I come over to iPhone Life once a week. The guides are, the quality is so good, and I'm so busy, I don't want to spend the time watching video, but as soon as I start watching the classes or the guides, it's so rich, so well done, and I've learned so much, and it's why I've got an Ultra.
Really?
Yes, absolutely. First of all, I'll tell you a little later, but I was resisting my Apple Watch for years. I bought two and returned them because I just didn't like wearing watches. But after watching you two and Colin...
With the Apple Watch course?
With the Apple Watch course, I would just click, you know, maybe 15, 20 minutes every Wednesday. I'd click a few minutes. And then you were so excited and it really did sound so intriguing that I finally ended up buying it. And then I just watched the 3 lessons again.
That's great.
Yeah,
I haven't
watched the Q&A yet, but it's really, if you're into this at all, if you want to really use these devices, then I absolutely recommend Insider.
Thanks, Hal. It is a great endorsement for a product when people in the company and our founder on their own time are going and watching these courses. I have to say, co-teaching the Apple Watch course got me so much more excited about my Apple Watch too. I've been using a ton of features I didn't know about before. So one last time, that's iPhoneLife.com/podcast discount. Go and get up to 40% off today. We have an insider question that came in recently that I think will be relevant to many of you listening. And that is, there's been two issues with the iPhone 15 line that have been circulating, an overheating issue, and then also your phone just shutting off at night. And so we had someone writing in asking what the deal was with that. When it comes to the overheating issue, luckily that has been resolved. In some ways, getting your iPhone 15 a little bit later is maybe okay, because then all the bugs have been worked out. By the time
lucky
you, get
you
it.
David.
I know, I was just going to say, I'm so lucky.
So iOS 17.0.3 has addressed this overheating issue. Apple rolled that out in response to the fact that phones were overheating to the point that they were shutting off some of the iPhone 15 Pros. There's still been an issue with some third-party apps like Instagram and a couple others. People have reported that their phones will heat up some. When I first powered up my iPhone 15 Pro Max, it got really hot and I was worried. I was like, oh, great. It's this issue everyone's been talking about. But since that initial setup, I haven't had an issue. How
I haven't
you?
Had a problem.
I've definitely learned to take the first few weeks of an Apple product release with a grain of salt, because Apple is such a big company and like there's so much buzz around new products that you get a lot of clicks if you write an article about some bug in a new Apple product. So every year, inevitably, there's some scandal of something wrong. And sometimes there's truth to it. Sounds like in this one, there is some overheating issues, but most of the time it's over-exaggerated. So, you know, I think it's important to kind of keep a skeptical eye on these sort of articles. But also, it's worth keeping an eye on because sometimes there is truth to it.
Yeah. And I mean, I think our recommendation would be, as Apple rolls out software updates, install them or have it auto update. Because if there are issues like this, Apple usually rolls out a fix pretty quickly.
Yeah.
As for devices shutting off at night, I have also not experienced this. There've been some rumors, like one fix for that is just restarting your phone, which I think a lot of people rarely even turn off their phone at all. You don't really need to. But anytime I'm having an issue with my iPhone, probably about, I restart it, and probably about 90% of the time it fixes it if an app is acting up. How about you guys?
You know, ironically, I've actually had an issue with my iPhone 14 Pro Max where it would just randomly brick every once in a while. And I would just look down and my phone would just be black and I couldn't turn it on.
Oh, wow.
Which is terrifying. And so I had to do a hard reset. And it's one of those little tricks that is worth kind of knowing how to do.
Oh.
So
you want to talk us through it?
I do, but I it's funny because I actually had this written down to talk about as something that like everybody should memorize how to do it. And here I am and I've forgotten it. So I am going to have to Google it like the rest of y'all.
This is different than a force shutdown.
It might be the same thing. So it's a force restart. So maybe the same thing.
Oh.
So you press and quickly release the up volume. You press and quickly release the down volume. And then you press and hold the side button. So the key there, and this has changed with the newer phones.
I can't imagine why you didn't memorize that.
Yeah.
I'm going to say it one more time. Press and quickly release the up button. Press and quickly release the down button. And then you press the and hold the side button, which is, of course, the power button. And I will say, it doesn't always work right away. So I've had to, whenever this happens, I have, maybe 10, 15 minutes of just total panic that my phone's just dead forever. And I'll try to and then I'll remember this hard reset rule, and then I'll try to do it and it still won't work. And then eventually it'll work. So it's good. The reason why it's good to memorize, maybe this is obvious, but if your phone is dead and you aren't near a computer, it's hard to Google things. So you have to fuss with it a little bit. But my iPhone 14 Pro, maybe once a month that'll happen to me.
But just to be clear, a hard reset doesn't mean you lose any data or anything.
Oh, yeah. No, you don't lose anything. It's literally like the equivalent of pressing and holding the power button on a Mac. It just forces it to restart. And for some reason, it just goes in this mode where the screen's black and non-responsive no matter what I do.
So Apple's term for it is a forced restart. Reset, I think, does usually imply you're resetting some settings or data. But this is not that.
Yes. Thank you.
Cool. So we do have a comment from a listener before we get into our hands-on review. We asked before who was planning on upgrading their phone, and Jean wrote in saying, I have purchased the iPhone 15 Pro Max. I will be giving my iPhone 14 Pro Max to my sister. I like the ringer switch. though I have taken to verbally using Siri to turn on and off Do Not Disturb, which is another
That's a good little bonus tip. Yeah.
Yeah. The Pro Max series is easier to see than the smaller models, and I have poor vision, so it works great for me. Thanks for writing in, Jane. So this was actually my first time ever getting a Max. So like in terms of my hands-on review, I'm going to talk about the new features, but I also want to talk about having the bigger screen finally.
And I just want to take this will probably be my last time to gloat. So I am going to gloat. Donna has spent years shaming me for the Max, telling me how big it is and how ridiculous it would be. And now she's finally on board. So
now,
Donna,
wait a minute, David. I don't know if you remember.
I knew this was coming.
Yeah.
So I immediately got the Max the first time it came out, and David sort of looked down, you know.
I did poo-poo it for a little bit too. Stories. I am an early convert, but Hal was, I think, the original Max owner at this company.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. I'm glad.
So that being
glad
said,
that's clear.
Yeah,
said.
Yeah, yes. We cleared it up. Hal is the founder of the company and also the founder of the Max. No, just kidding. Go ahead, Donna.
That being said, I wouldn't say I only have positive reviews of it. Because typing is harder. I really like, the display on the iPhone 15 Pro Max is so nice. And for watching videos, it's great. And all my photos, looking through my photo library, like there are a lot of things I love about it, but it is still like kind of unwieldy.
Yeah.
It's hard to text one-handed. I don't love the one-handed keyboard option, even though I know I could do that. I also don't like reachability feature. I don't even know if that's like still a thing, but I don't like it.
I never use it. And you're right. I never use it to the point where I actually don't even know if it exists anymore.
But do you guys have any tips on how do you text?
No, you learn to live with it. Like I should have given a few more words of warning, because it's definitely, that is the trade-off, is I cannot text with one hand very well. The one tip I would say, which is it doesn't solve it, but I found that swiping is my best bet.
I've been doing that more, but I'm bad at it.
So yeah.
What do you mean swiping?
So,
like swipe to text. Trace the letters.
Yeah.
So that's something you can always do, but it requires some finesse, and I'm not that good at it.
Maybe this is a little bit too, I don't know, anti-technology or something, but I view it sometimes as like the positive is it forces me to slow down. Like there's very few moments where I only have one hand available and it's an emergency and I have to text. Like I can usually just wait until I have two hands available.
That would be an option. I guess I could consider.
But the frustration is real. I am with you on that.
You know, I've never one-handed texted.
Really?
Really?
Oh, so you don't, this is not a problem you have encountered.
Yeah, but of course I've already
texted. Do you guys use thumbs? Or do you use pointers?
No, I don't even know what I do.
Very much thumb.
You know, I do. No, I don't. I have a unique one. I use my right thumb and my left pointer.
Well, that is unique, yes.
No, I guess I do. I guess I do use my thumb.
So I don't know if I would recommend it. Okay, so that's my commentary for the large display. Okay. It's great, except for I'm going to have to learn how to text.
Yeah.
Or I'm going to have to stop failing to multitask the way that I usually do.
So wait a minute to respond and it's going to be tragic. So other than that, though, you're liking it. Does it fit in your pockets, your purse, like you're okay with the size?
I've really embraced wearing a fanny pack and it fits perfectly in my fanny pack.
So it's a lifestyle.
It's a lifestyle. It's not great for a pocket. I can fit it in my back pocket, but it definitely looks bunchy and not great.
Yeah.
But I will do it if I need to. What
and
about
I
you,
never
Hal?
Understood back pocket for important things because you sit down, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you have no complaints with the size. You're happy with your larger
phone. This is my size. Okay. I always get big everything. I've learned that, actually. Even my iPad, it's the Pro. It's the biggest.
Well, and your Apple Watch, too.
And my Ultra. That's when I finally,
Okay, so let me ask you guys some more questions. So we talked about the action button. The camera is obviously the other huge upgrade. I'll go one at a time. Donna, what has been your experience with the camera?
So this is actually my favorite feature by far of the iPhone 15 Pro Max. And that is now when you take a photo just in the regular photo mode. So that's like what by default, what your camera opens to. And you take a picture, you can convert it to a portrait afterwards and you can have live photo turned on. And that's something that's been this big trade-off for me for years is I love having live photos because for group shots and just selfies, even like you can get the best of 3 seconds afterwards, and you can turn them into little movies and things like that. So I always want live on. And for action shots, it's great too. But then you're missing out on the beautiful bokeh effect of portraits.
Well, and conversely, for portraits, which I agree, I love that blurred background bokeh effect, I find it so frustrating. You're trying to take a photo, especially if you have like kids or pets and you want that background. And it's like, take two steps forward. Now take three steps back. Now one step forward. And you're like, oh my God, I just want to take this photo. So it's really nice to have a be able to just take quickly, I would imagine.
Yeah. So it must be like the technology is getting better that more photos can be a portrait too. Cause yeah, it feels less finicky. Like you're able to get that effect without having to like dance around for a few minutes.
Well, and it's strange that it's only available on the iPhone 15 Pro, because you're right. It must be a hardware solution. Now, do you find, so my question with that is, do you find the portrait mode to be as high quality?
So one caveat is it's not as finicky as it used to be, but you do have to be within a certain range for the option to show up afterwards to turn into live.
So I'm confused. When I didn't watch the i15 guide yet.
Oh, okay.
I mean the class yet. So how do you do that? I've never done anything with portrait mode at all. I'll admit it.
So I'll walk you through it. So you open your camera app, then the default mode is just photo, and you're not in portrait capture mode, and so you just take your shot. And then when you open up the photo and tap edit, you should see that little f-stop icon that indicates portrait. And when you tap that, it'll change it to portrait mode, and it'll even have that toggle, that like side scrolling list at the bottom that lets you.
So which is the
So you need to be also. You need to take a picture of a person, a plant, or pet. Because it needs to like recognize something that you're taking a portrait of.
I don't know if you can see this, but
And we have a lot of listeners too. But yes, Hal's holding up a photo that I would have thought would be eligible for it, and I'm not seeing it. So it sounds like that is the person has to be within a certain range.
Oh, I have a picture of my wife looking at a butterfly on a leaf.
And I think it's
it's a profile of her face. Maybe it didn't recognize a face, but it does need to be like it needs to recognize a face. But I think some plants also work. Uh-huh. So it's not
perfect.
It's not across the board every single photo, but when you're framing up your shot. Like once it recognizes your face, the F icon shows up in the lower left corner of my display, which indicates that it can become a portrait. And actually, if I tap that in my viewfinder, it is turning on portrait mode. And I can even then from there choose which face I'm focusing on and then snap my shot. But even if I snap my shot, I can apply that after the fact. And to me, that's what I'm loving about it, because most of the time it allows me just to take a picture really fast and do what I want with it later, which I think is, you know, what you want.
Well,
you don't want to have to fuss with it.
I also can't tell you how many beautifully framed portrait photos I've taken with the lovely bokeh effect and someone's blinking. So like the live photo combined with portrait mode really helps to make sure you get a good photo.
Yes. And so.
And it doesn't matter. You could take it in one time, five times. Does it matter in terms of the telephoto lens whether you're using that or not?
Is it only in 1x?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. I'm pretty sure that it doesn't matter.
I don't think so, because typically you can do portrait
in any. 2x it's still showing up. 5x it's still showing up.
Okay, cool.
And so the feature that is on all devices running iOS 17, though, just to let you all know, is that you can change the subject of your portrait photo after the fact now, as long as you're running iOS 17.
Oh, wow. For all phones.
Yeah. But very cool. For other phones, you have to have taken the photo in portrait in order for that to work.
I see.
So.
And how about you, Hal? Have you used the camera much?
Oh, I love the camera. And I love actually the 5x telephoto. I really like.
Okay. That's one of my main questions. Yeah.
Yeah. Because especially we're in rural Iowa and I've got a lot of land and walking out and seeing the sunrise and maybe 5x photo, like just some, I know people can't see, but they're just some incredible photos I've got of the sunrise with the pink sky. And then the deer, we have deer that we can capture. And so when I can do 5x video on the deer, It's really neat. And then also on wildflowers close, you know, and seeing mm-hmm. and seeing the mushrooms and the wildflowers. It's really, I'm totally enjoying my camera.
That's great. Because I found on the 14 Pro Max, it has the 3x zoom and so the 5x zoom. And I found the 3x was not a zoom that I use that much. It was like a little too close to 2. And often when I did 3x zoom, it just zoomed a little too much. Whereas 5x, I had the same impression that Hal was sort of getting at, that I could actually use that to take photos of something pretty far away that I wouldn't normally be able to take a photo of.
So yeah. What I used my 5x zoom for recently, that was a great use case for it, was my nephew's soccer game.
Oh, cool.
It let me get close enough to see him, you know, making his shot. And you don't lose any resolution and I can still be on the sidelines.
Yes.
So that's pretty amazing.
Very cool.
Yeah.
I'd say the camera, I agree with you, with the iPhone 14 Pro, I actually didn't end up caring about the optical zoom that much because it wasn't enough.
Yeah, it wasn't enough different than the 2. And I found myself using the 2 even though I knew it was worse quality.
Yeah, same actually. The Pro Max, I would say it's worth it for the camera.
Now, if I understand this right, it doesn't matter in terms of, I can take any kind of, like, I could do 3 or 4 with this iPhone Pro Max and it doesn't affect the quality?
So we have a couple people on our team who are better at really getting into the technicalities of this.
Yeah.
But my understanding of it is that when you open your camera app, you've got your different zoom options laid out for you. Like the one in our case, it's the 1, 2, and 5x zoom. And that when you tap those, you're switching between lenses. And if you start like scaling using that little slider to go in between, you're actually not using the proper lens for that amount of zoom always. And so like you're leaving it up to chance more, like that you actually might be using a digital zoom instead.
So for example, if you took the slider and you went to 4.9,
right,
it would be a very it would be a very pixelated photo, where if you actually toggle it to 5, it literally switches the lens it's going to use.
Telephoto.
Oh, I had thought, I had heard or something about the with the new Pro Max.
So there is some of that, and that is the 2X. So the Apple has this new technology where basically their camera is so high megapixel that the 2X it's not an actually new lens, but they have so many megapixels that even at the distorted quality, it's still very high quality. So the 2X is sort of the exception to the rule, where if you're really a purist, you would say that even that probably is distorting the photo a little bit. But most people are okay with it. It's not very noticeable. But in general, you're better toggling between Apple's presets than trying to go in between them.
I see. Okay.
And right. One last point on this while we're in the weeds of photo stuff. You can always, after the fact, zoom in through cropping, which is the literal exact same thing as using a digital zoom. So in other words, there's no benefit to going from like 2 to 2.1, 2.2. You can do that after the fact. You're much better off just toggling between 1, 2, and 5 or whatever your options are for whatever phone you have.
Yeah, that's my understanding as well.
Okay, now that we're back on this, have you guys noticed that the phone is faster at all? Is the processor noticing any difference?
It is, and I think that that's one of those things that you don't like upgrade a phone for. At least just, I had the 14 Pro before, so it was already pretty fast. Like that alone wouldn't have made me upgrade, but it is really nice. Like, I feel like a lot of times just having things be like a little bit zippier, just you don't want to go back after that. And I do think I've noticed it being faster.
I probably have. I had the 13 Max.
Okay.
But why I love the difference. So my 13 Max, about 3 months ago, the Face ID stopped working.
Oh, wow. So this is a big upgrade.
So I had to type in my code every time I wanted to open my phone. You know, I did a very simple code, but it was quite annoying. And so having this is just like, it's like breathing again, you know? It was actually a way of not using my phone as much.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah.
So faster. I read a weird article today that said that the new iPhones have twice as fast download speeds on like when using data or internet. Have you guys noticed that at all? Because I have actually been frustrated with my 14 Pro. Like the modem seems not great. Like I always have a hard time getting reception. My download speeds, upload speeds haven't been as good as I would thought. Have you guys noticed any of that? I know it's one of those things that's sort of sneaky in the background unless you're testing it.
Yeah, like I wouldn't. That's not something I've paid attention to really notice, but I have noticed it being fast.
And I'm assuming no issues with battery life.
So the battery, it's fine, but I wouldn't say the battery's amazing. I've noticed that
I was surprised how I'm down to 15-20% on some days.
Definitely, yeah. Like if I don't top it off with power, it'll be like running out at the end of the day. Yeah. So whereas like actually my 14 Pro until the last couple months, which for some reason it slowed down then, would last me like a day and a half. And the 15 Pro Max, I'd say, is just like an all-day battery for me. And it could be like with all the new features, I'm using my phone more. That's very possible. Hmm. But I wouldn't say, like, I was expecting it to be a little better.
Yeah. For the Pro Max, you'd think you'd get like a day and a half.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm not.
So for me, it's new, the always-on thing.
Because
I didn't have that in the 13. I love it. It's so much nicer to, you know, you don't have to turn it on to get the time and of course, now that I have my Apple Watch, I don't know that either. I really like that. And I guess it's a feature for all of them, but I like the side thing at night where the
standby mode. Yeah, I love the digital watch. Mode.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been using that religiously. And I like,
it's okay. I mean, it's this little, what do you call this thing? The little thing on
the dynamic island.
The dynamic island. Yeah. 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 So that's nice too.
Yeah. I forgot, like, since I've been using the dynamic island for a while, I forgot about not having it.
And so I noticed you don't have a case either.
I was getting ready to ask this. Neither of you guys have a case.
Yeah. So I really like the look of the titanium phone. I know from watching online videos, breakdown videos, that the titanium is actually not that solid. So I'm definitely being a little risky right now. But my idea with that is just that it's supposed to be sturdier than other iPhones. And so I'm just winging it right now. But I do have some cases coming and I will put one on.
And do you guys, you guys are really winging, because I'm not seeing any glass screen protectors on these phones.
You know, I've never used, I know you've
really?
Warned us for
oh,
years
yeah.
on
I'm
your
such
podcast,
a proponent.
And I've never used one.
All right, well, thanks for joining us, Hal. No, just kidding.
I know.
And is this like a conscious, is this a conscious choice, or have you guys just not gotten around to getting screen protectors yet?
I haven't gotten around to it yet, but I have stuff coming this week.
Okay.
But I just decided to use my phone without it in the meantime, and it is nice. Like, I got the black iPhone 15 Pro Max, and I know you sent me videos that it collects fingerprints, but I think it looks beautiful.
And does
and
it? I mean, bearing out?
I have very sweaty hands, and so yes, but I don't think it's that bad.
I don't. I was actually observing yesterday, and I was like, that doesn't look that bad.
Yeah.
How about you? How you went with the? Is that the dark blue or the black?
The dark blue.
The dark blue is really pretty.
Which that was my other option, you know. And I'd be holding my phone right now. It is a very pretty color. So you guys are happy with your colors?
Yeah.
Yeah. I would have liked the white one or whatever it was. But then I would have waited. Had to wait 2 more weeks.
Yeah.
So then
we'd have to be you.
You don't want to be me here. Yeah. I'm not having fun.
So the screen protector, you know, you're probably right. But I just, first of all, I know you've said some of them are easy to actually put on.
Yeah.
But the thought of putting one on is, I'm just not the mechanic.
Okay.
Like,
and I get that because you and I like started using iPhones in the era where it would like take all day and every time you do it, it would be wrong and misaligned.
It's like the dust and bubbles under there.
And they were plastic and felt terrible.
Yeah.
The newer ones, especially, you get ones that have the applicator. So it lines it up for you.
Yeah.
I do sometimes get dust bubbles. I'm not going to lie. But most of the time, it's very quick and easy. And I find glass, you don't feel the difference, which to me was a big thing.
Yeah,
like the plastic screen protectors just felt terrible.
Yes.
It just, what it does do though, is it makes your phone a little clunkier. It's true. Like it's another, just right now I'm like, whoa, my phone is so like lightweight. Even having the Pro Max, it feels really like sleek.
Yeah.
It takes away from that a little bit, I'll be honest. But it might save you $250.
You know, I hate to say this, but it's like I don't learn. I've cracked screens. I've scratched screens. I've dropped the phones. I've paid a small fortune through the years in repairing my phones. But this time, I'd really like to try going out. I know you guys are trying to put the fear of, you know, in me in terms of like you trying to help me out, but.
Well, it's funny because
how long,
there's,
I can last
there's something about the titanium that did the same thing to me. Like, here's what I'm planning on doing. I splurged on the Apple Care that if I drop my phone or get stolen, see, I can replace it.
I don't like insurance.
I don't like it either because I'm paying like an extra $100, right, which is like 10% of the phone value. Plus, if I have to replace it, I'm paying $250 or some crazy thing like that. So it's not a good plan. And I was going to compromise. These are all compromises I'm making with myself here, and have a screen protector, but no case. That's where I'm landing. But I did do month to month for the insurance, being like, I'll try for a month and probably cancel the insurance.
Yeah.
Have you been watching the breakdown videos, though, that have shown that, like, the drop tests and all that, that actually the titanium's not that?
Yeah, no, but I'm doing the same thing you are. I'm somehow just being like, yeah, but it should be better. And then holding on to that despite evidence to the contrary.
Yeah. What do you think of the titanium? Have you noticed it being, like, lighter?
Yeah. Yes, I've noticed it. I like the feel of it. I don't like the look of this as much as the feel I really like.
It has a little bit of a rounded edge, whereas the previous generation phones are like more of a squared edge.
Yeah. It may be because I was actually using a case in the last one. But
yeah, so there's this full right angle on the other phones, and this one has more.
Yeah,
like
I guess it's okay, but it's closer to the bezel, right?
Yeah, a little close to edge.
I think what I miss is this the shiny. Is that stainless steel, right?
I actually
order
don't
of the pro.
Yeah, the back is glass, which is why in theory I would have thought it would break faster, but who knows? Okay, so I want to ask Hal about his Apple Watch.
Yes.
But before we move on, any other features that are notable for either of you for the new phones?
Yeah, I would say.
Okay, which is in and of itself telling, right? Like, it sounds like, if I can kind of read between the lines here, it's a nice upgrade. If you're coming from the 14 Pro, it's a incremental upgrade that is noticeable and nice, but probably not necessary. If you're coming from the 13, you have a phone that might be breaking down a little bit more and a little bit more noticeable, and there's more features like Dynamic Island, which you hadn't gotten to discover yet.
Right, and the always on. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So, Hal, you have held out for Apple Watch for years.
Yes.
And what, other than being inspired by Don and Colin, what made you take the leap?
Well, first of all, so when it first came out, 2015, 2016, you know, I'm geeky enough, I wanted to try it, even though I've never liked watches, just never worn watches, because I don't like the physical feel on my wrist.
Mm.
And after trying it for about a week or two, I let it sit for about 6 months and sold it on eBay. And then I kept hearing all the health benefits. So in 2019 or 2020, I bought another one. Same story, let it sit.
Yeah.
And so this time, I guess, but I have to say, watching you and all the complications and seeing all the data that you could have just accessible. And then Noah, our COO, having for a year watching him with this big Ultra. I decided, you know, I'm just going to try it again. I'm going to really give it a chance. I'm going to wear it for 2 weeks and then decide. And actually, to be honest, the first week, each day, it sort of grew on me.
Mm-hmm.
And by the, now I love it. You couldn't take it away from
really?
Me. Oh, yeah.
So what do you think was the, like, turning point?
Yes, just so many cool, you know, as a geek, you know, all the things you can do and all the access, whether it's the workout and watching, you know, when I'm walking in the woods and seeing, my, you know, my heart rate and how far I've gone and my pace and, you know, so many of these, you know, the steps that I've taken with that one app, that you guys
recommend? Pedometer Plus.
Yeah. And it's just the temperature, and then now with the, I guess it's new, but for me it's not new, is the widgets, you know, able to see the, just scroll up and just being able to see.
WatchOS 10 is nice.
Yes, yes. And it's not been, I've tried, this is my second band. I'm trying different bands. And this is a cheaper band than the Apple, I bought this with the Apple Watch. This is, I forgot the name.
And that's
it's
the
one
I have. It's like the, Infinite Loop, I think is what it's called, actually.
There's something about walking. I forgot what it was called. Okay. But anyways, yeah, maybe you're right. The Loop. Maybe that's what.
And basically what it is, it's made of nylon and it's Velcro. So you can, what I love about that band is that you can adjust it to in any size, so you can get a really precise fit on your wrist.
Yeah, and then I just got this yesterday, a couple days ago, on eBay, on Amazon. It's really cheap, like $5-$10.
Oh, wow.
But it got a lot of stars and nylon, and I almost like it better. It's easier. I don't feel the rubbing at all, and so I still feel the weight of the watch, but overall, it's just fun. And you know, one of the things I remember when you first got the watch, you were always looking at your watch.
Yes, and now
that's
I'm
you.
Still doing it, like in this podcast.
Yeah, and now I realize
it's gorgeous.
Yes, the display, it's big enough. Like I said, my philosophy is get the biggest within the context of small. You know, which is, you know, the phone, the iPad, or the watch.
Yeah.
And so you never worry. I've been doing this, you know, we actually started the company in 86, and I've been using handhelds forever. And, you know, I've learned several things. Get the biggest within the context of the environment, like the biggest watch. Don't worry. Make sure you never have to worry about battery. And make sure you never have to worry about memory.
Yeah, storage is where we're always preaching that. Get a little too much storage, not a little, not enough.
This is a 512.
Oh, wow. So you took that one step further. Because to me, 256 is still the sweet spot.
Yeah, I actually, right after you asked me if there was anything else to add, I remembered that with the iPhone 15 Pro Max, the starting storage capacity is 256 instead of 128, which is what I had on my iPhone 14. And it is so nice just feeling like I can download podcasts, I can download music, I can kind of do whatever I want, and I don't have to worry about it.
And you know, you have a phone for 1-2 years at least, and the amount of time you end up spending fussing with storage, it's just not worth it.
Yeah.
And this is an interesting year because, like you're saying, I've spent, 10 years now telling people to not get the base storage model, and this is sort of the first year where 256 is enough. You can get the base storage model.
But for not for me.
That's an interesting thing too, because I was all worried about the price hike on the iPhones.
Yeah.
Everyone was saying that this year there are going to be more, but really it equaled out because they raised that base storage capacity on the iPhone 15 Pro Max, which is the only one that they increased the price on, which is what you would pay for that amount anyway. So it really ended up being the same price as
before. Except for now with the 512, they upped to $200 for it to get the extra 512.
But
I have so many. I have a lot of podcasts. I do coaching, and I record all the sessions, and so I've got tons of recordings, and then all the photos. And I'm actually past my 256 limit. You know.
Oh wow.
Yeah. And so my other one, my 13 Max was 512 too.
We didn't talk about USB-C. I realized that's a whole other thing. I just got the little keychain USB-C, drive. That's the word I'm looking for on my keychain so that I can transfer files on and off of my iPhone. I actually haven't used it yet, to be totally honest, but I am excited about the possibility of being able to transfer like videos and audio recordings off my iPhone. It seems like there could be uses at work that I'll use it for. How about you? What have you been thinking of the USB-C?
Well, if I could, my particular voice recording program is not very good in transferring. Mm. You know, if I could figure out how to just get rid of, you know, put all of them on I'd love that. That would really free up a lot of space. So at this point, I'm not thinking about it, but if you know, I'm open to the possibility, that's for sure.
One thing that's a little bit of a bummer about it is that while USB-C, I have USB-C ports on both my MacBook and on my iPhone, you can't use the same charger on both anyway. Like, I plugged in my iPhone to my MacBook USB-C charger and it wouldn't charge.
That's strange.
Isn't that strange?
You should be able to. You can always, my understanding, and you know me, I'm obsessed with cables, you can always use too many watts, you just can't use not enough watts. So you should be able to charge an iPhone with a Mac charger, but you can't charge a Mac with an iPhone charger.
Is it like recommended though?
Yeah, it's fine. It should be fine.
Huh. I don't know. That was the experience I had with the charger, but I shouldn't have brought it up before researching.
I could be wrong because obviously I don't have the phone, so I haven't tested this yet. But usually it's fine. Like I very frequently charge my phone now, and I'll just use a USB-C to Lightning with my Mac charger.
I'll have to report back on that. Okay. Because that the thing that's strange with USB-C is that like you still would have different recommended chargers for different devices. Or are you planning on using your MacBook charger for everything, assuming it works?
No, because I have the Pro. I have the MacBook Pro, and it's a really big, bulky charger. So I actually, on Prime Day, just re-upped on a few small micro USB-C charge adapters.
Oh, nice.
And they have this new technology. It's been out for like a year or two. It's called GaN, where now you can get really small chargers that are good enough to charge your iPhone.
The one difference that I hadn't used MagSafe before.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
And so now, you know, with my AirPods Pro and my iPhone, and my charger is set up that way, so mm-hmm. I never plug it in anymore. You know, using the C, I just use the MagSafe at night. You know, on a, and that way I can also see the time, the digital clock.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So for your watch, get back to your watch.
Yeah.
What features are you particularly enjoying?
Again, it's just so much data, and also. Of just different kinds of things that, you know, I would never have access to, like my heartbeat and steps that I've taken. And then also just when the phone rings. And it was so cool to be able to talk on the phone with this. Now, do you guys have a cellular connection?
No. I believe, does Colin have a cellular connection?
On his watch?
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's one of those things where some people, when we taught the Apple Watch class, some people loved it, and some people, like me, were like, it's really not necessary. Yeah. There's not a lot of situations in which I'm have my watch and not my phone.
Yeah.
I'm assuming you do not?
No, okay. I don't. And but just having the jiggle, you know, when the messages come in, and having the messages show up, and it's just surprisingly convenient.
I feel like you're having the same problem that like all Apple Watch enthusiasts have, which is that it's the little things that make it great. And so it's hard to explain to people. You know, I'm sure if you're sitting here listening to this and you don't have an Apple Watch, like, oh, great, you can see a message on your wrist. But it's just really convenient and a very nice user experience. Last question for you. I see you went with the Ultra.
Yes.
And big screen, that was the seller. Was there any other reasons or any features you're liking about the Ultra in particular?
No, it's just the bigness of it. And, you know, you can see, it's easy to touch and get the complications and see it and all that. I just like the bigness of it. And it doesn't seem to be that much more. I mean, it's sort of ugly in one sense anyway, these Apple. Let me see yours. Yeah.
It's not. I agree. When I saw it advertised, I thought it was going to be huge. And when I see it in people's wrists, it doesn't look unwieldy. Yeah. Sorry, I'll hold up to the camera for those watching so you can see it.
Yeah.
I have confirmed that it must have been some issue just with mine specifically. You can charge your iPhone, iPad, or any Apple device with a Apple MacBook power adapter.
Okay.
So I don't know why that didn't work for me at the time, but that makes me more a fan of USB-C because, like, yes, the MacBook one is bulky, but if I'm traveling, I'm going to need to bring that for my MacBook so I can just bring that and charge everything with it.
Now, I can venture a guess. If nothing else, at least you got me talking about cables. So there was some benefit to this conversation.
Yeah.
With lightning cables, so for iPhones, you need to have it be, I'm forgetting the code, it's like MDI certified. And I can't remember
MFI.
The exact MFI. Right. Thank you. Apple literally has a chip in a lightning cable and in their iPhone to make sure that you're using a charger that is certified so that you use a high quality cable. Because if you use a really low quality cable, it can damage your phone. So it's a protection mechanism that Apple has put in place to make sure that you are using high quality cables. Also, it's very Apple. It's like making it a walled garden, even for a cable. But now, and I believe that's, in my theory, that's part of why Apple has stuck with lightning cables for so long. But now there's a myriad of USB-C cables. So my guess is you were trying to use a cable that was not MFI certified,
and
your phone was complaining about it.
Could be.
I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But I think that takeaway, now that we are moving to a USB-C only world, is still important. I mean, A, make sure you're using high quality cables, but B, you can always charge down but not charge up. And what I mean by that is if you have an adapter that supports charging in a computer, so let's say a 60-watt adapter, you can charge an iPhone that charges at 20 watts, but you cannot use a 20-watt adapter to charge your Mac. You can, you're not going to damage it, but it's not really going to work very well.
Yeah, the principle is that your phone won't draw more power than it's designed to, exactly. No matter what's available. So that's that.
All right. I think we are nearing the end. We were going to do an apps and gear section. We're running out of time, but we don't have you very often, Hal. So I'm going to let you be our apps and gear spokesperson for today. You said you had an Apple Watch app?
Yeah. There's this this cool app called Whisper Memo. And so I'm right now, I'm working on a book. I'm writing a book. And ideas happen all throughout the day. And all I have to do is I touch this complication, press start, and now right now I'm recording, and I have this great new idea for my book. I'm going to, idea, stop, and now it's going to show up in my email.
Oh, cool. So yes. It emails it to you.
Yeah, it transcribes it and then emails me.
It transcribes it?
Yeah,
that's
and then
nice.
Emails it. Yeah.
That is very cool.
Yeah.
And is it free?
It's free.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Okay. Whisper Memo.
It's interesting that there are more like free transcription services now, because that's something a lot of times you've had to pay for.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, insiders, stick around. We are going to share a few tips. But for the rest of you, please email us at podcast@iPhoneLife.com and share your hands-on reviews with the iPhone 15 line. It doesn't have to be the Pro Max. It could be any iPhone 15. Let us know what you think. That's podcast@iPhoneLife.com. Thanks so much for joining us, Hal.
Thanks
so
for
fun getting your hands-on
tape. Oh, I enjoyed it. Yeah, it's great.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.